Longhorn fans are fired up about hosting the number one team in the nation, the Kansas Jayhawks. The Jayhawks have won 8 in a row since losing their only game of the season. And tonight they'll have their hands full. Kansas and Texas, always a great matchup, and it's next. Sean, thank you very much. 7-3, the Longhorns with a big start. Balbe misses that shot for the Horns. Freshman Henry here, and quickly Shalon Collins, and you can score it.
I think that was both a basket and a goaltending basket, Brent. I think that both things happened. And Collins obviously made it, but I also think it was tipped when it was up on the glass.
Yeah, the official ruled that their goaltending, no question about that. 7-5. You can take a look at the standings. As you do, of course, the Jayhawks ranked number one in the nation. Texas has lost 4 of its last 6 games, and that came after they were ranked number one. Now, the story for the Longhorns tonight, as you're watching it on top, Johnson drew a start instead of Mason. Mason had started 58 consecutive games, and here is Pittman having the ball knocked away and out of bounds. It'll go to the Jayhawks.
There was an example of the Kansas double team really working well. They got into Pittman. They blocked his vision. They didn't really give him a chance to get the ball anywhere. So the Kansas double team right now is 1-1.
Mason, 58 consecutive starts, but he just was not producing. And Rick Barnes made the change. Aldridge's first hook shot is short, but he tracks it down. Here's Collins for the Jayhawks. Off the dribble drive. Pull up Jay. Off Henry's hands. And it will be Jayhawks ball. Damian James and Johnson reaching in.
At this point, Brent, I'm really impressed with the approach that Texas has. How much they're into the game, how tough they're playing defensively, and the ball and player movement they've had offensively. This is the best I've seen Texas play in quite a while, at least to this point in the game. We've only played 3.5 minutes, but it's been a really good start for them.
And Bob Wanmany will come in and replace Pittman. So they get Pittman an early break here at the 16-28 mark in the first half. Marcus Morris and one.
All right, now we're going to see help be a little bit too late here. And Morris gets the ball all alone on the post, and the help is moving when he goes up with the shot. That's the that results in the foul and the chance for Morris to have a three-point play. Texas got mixed up on defense there a little bit, and that's why Morris was so open at the foul line.
Completes a three-point play. Let's take a look at what happened to Pittman as he was going out of bounds. May have run into a chair over there on that side, and looks like he took a very awkward step, didn't it, as he goes off to the sideline here in the early going. Bradley, the freshman, handling the ball for the Horns. James fronted, and so Bradley coming in is fouled. Our officials here tonight, Scott Thornley, Tom Eads, and Doug Shows.
Bradley took advantage of that open lane along the baseline, Brent. That's the absolute best place to attack the bucket on a drive from. And Bradley did a very good job getting to the bucket and drawing the foul. Johnson also moved out of the post position to give Bradley a little room.
Watching the number one team in the nation, the Jayhawks. After losing to Tennessee, they've won 8 in a row.
Brown is a kid that Rick Barnes thinks can be a great player here at Texas. As soon as he can bring himself to adjusting to the athletic abilities and the strength of college players.
Again, that's James' second three of the night. Off to a hot start, and the Horns regain the lead.
James has been open on both of the threes that he set, and he had really good footwork. That's a result of the ball movement that Texas has had thus far.
Sharon Collins is hooked by Wanmany out on top. So Damian James, the leader for the Horns, drains his second three, and we've got a timeout. I ain't trying to be politically correct, but
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Bud Light. With a just right taste that's not too heavy, not too light, the difference is drinkability.
We welcome you to ESPN's Big Monday, presented by Bud Light. It is part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco on ESPN. Texas with an early lead on the number one team in the country, the Kansas Jayhawks. Today, welcome everybody with Bob Knight and Holly Rowe. I'm Brett Buss. Here's the truth, folks. When I used to cover Indiana basketball and Coach Knight was there, I always made sure that either Billy Packer or Dick Vitale went in to see the coach before the game. It wasn't an easy conversation. Now I send you in to see Bill Self. Did you see any difference, Mr. Knight?
I was a lot more impressed with how calm Bill was and yet how much he was into the preparation of the game, but how relaxed he was as opposed to my calmness and relaxation prior to a game. Far more impressed with Self than I was with me.
Good job, Coach. We're making him a journalist, folks. Holly Rowe, what's the story about Johnson starting tonight instead of Mason for the Longhorns?
Well, you know, Gary Johnson is getting his first start of the season, and Rick Barnes says, I was reluctant to do this, put Justin Mason on the bench to start the game because of everything he's meant for Texas basketball. He's a senior, and he's our heartbeat. But the problem is he just wasn't scoring. He was shooting 18% from the three-point line and just about 3 points a game, allowing teams to sag off him and not pay attention to him defensively. So they insert Gary Johnson. We've already seen him be aggressive on offense. They need to make him be guarded by Kansas and occupy a defender.
Now, Holly, he stays out there in this Texas zone right now, and firing against it is the freshman Henry. He's now 1 of 3 from three-point range. Johnson posted his second double-double of the year on Saturday at Oklahoma.
When you set up in a zone like Texas did, if they don't score against it the first time, it's not a bad idea to use it the second time and make them score against it. Make them find a way to get inside against it before you go out of it.
Keith Morris has joined his brother Marcus. Marcus, number 22, jumps out on Brown defensively, and Brown on the line. That's a 2. 1 foot on the line.
You know, as we mentioned earlier, Brown is a guy that Rick Barnes expects to be a tremendous contributor to basketball here at Texas.
Swatted out of bounds. Pittman back on the floor after taking that little bit of a misstep as he goes out of bounds. And let's watch Pittman here, Coach.
Pittman does a really good job going up after the ball without committing a foul. Texas back in his zone.
Sean Collins, trigger man out on top. Taylor on the floor for the first time for the Jayhawks. Collins looking for a seam, comes across to the left side. Morningstar misses the runner.
Pittman did a very good job in the middle of that zone, making it tough for Morningstar to get to the bucket.
James misses. Johnson underneath has it knocked away. James again.
See, another thing that Johnson adds is a real big, quick body. Johnson got that first rebound to allow James to score.
Marcus Morris has an injured hand. Marcus Morris needs attention on the Kansas bench. Timeout. Well, Marcus appeared to injure his hand, Bob, in underneath the basket.
I don't know. Did he catch it on the backboard when he went up for the rebound? I couldn't see. We didn't get a clear picture of it there. Here he might.
Looks like he came back away with his hand up underneath the backboard. I think you're right. It may have jammed a finger or a thumb.
That looks like a thumb or a finger that he hurt there.
He is still receiving attention over there in the corner. Marcus Morris, once conference play started, he became the Jayhawks' leading scorer. And, of course, this team has stayed healthy throughout the year. And that, as you know, if you follow the college game, so critical now as we approach March Madness. Collins turns it over.
That's a mistake trying to dribble the ball over on the baseline against the zone. You just can't do that. You've got two guys you've got to beat, and there we see a freshman mistake made by Bradley in losing the ball in what was going to be a good breakaway situation for him.
As Marcus heads back to the locker room with that hand injury, and Holly, of course, will keep us up to date on what that situation is. Taylor loads the block. Here's Aldridge. Been quiet so far tonight. Inside, outside, Morningstar's three ball is good.
I think Morningstar gives them the best outside threat they have. He's not the only three-point shooter they have, but I think the way he sets up and the way he gets open gives them their best chance at it.
Markeith still on the floor. The Morris is knocked away. Johnson turns it over. Head man, bad pass. Gave it back. Here's Bradley.
Kansas really doing a good job, and Morris did there, getting on top of Johnson on the baseline, not giving him any post move at all, any room to get to the bucket.
Morningstar down. James is Jay, not there. And it will go over. Ball out of bounds. Let's take one more look here at number 22 as he goes up high and his hand appeared to hit the backboard as he reaches for it. And Holly, what is the prognosis?
Well, guys, I didn't get a chance to talk with Bill Calgill, their trainer, as he took him to the locker room, but I'll check on the way back. But what I observed on the bench is that he has a dislocated finger. Several teammates tried to hold him as he winced in great pain as they tried to fix the finger, but it wasn't working, so they've taken him to the locker room, a place where they can work a little bit easier and not put him through such a public display of pain, guys.
All right, Holly, and meanwhile, the Jayhawks turn it over. Brown coming back here for the Horns is cut off. James on a tap, and there's offensive foul. Used his forearm.
Texas is at its best when they've got good movement, and Brown's got to get off the dribble just a little bit. He and Bradley sometimes have the ball too much on the dribble, and that slows down their offense a little bit.
You saw the definitive look at Marcus Morris dislocating the finger, as Holly reported. And Aldridge spins inside, tap, no. Battle for the ball out of bounds, and they step out of bounds. It'll be Kansas basketball. So we will take a break. The Longhorns, with a promising start, lead the number one team in the nation. This week on the ESPN family of networks, just some wonderful matchups. Tomorrow night, the SEC, Tennessee against Vanderbilt and Nashville, Purdue and Michigan State up in East Lansing, Connecticut and Syracuse on Wednesday, Duke and North Carolina, and boy, the Tar Heels gone on a retreat this year, and then Tennessee and Kentucky come back on Saturday. And of course, if you think of Big 12, these two teams since the founding of this conference back in the 90s have truly been the most dominant rivalry. You can see the most wins in conference history, and big edge for the Jayhawks. Six tournament titles to three for the Longhorns, but they've combined to win a lot of hardware here. They've been ranked and the most players in the Big 12 to play in the NBA coming from these two schools. And right now, Bill Self sends Tyrell Reed, a junior from Burlington, Kansas, out onto the floor, and Tyrell misses his first shot. Markeith can't rebound, but Aldridge does.
It's really, really surprising that Reed didn't use a shot fake. He's a very good outside shooter, but he works to get good shots, and he took that one under an awful lot of pressure. There,
Marcus Morris, with that injured hand, has returned to the Kansas bench. And looks like it's on his right hand. Hamilton in for the first time as the Longhorns make some substitutions. Chapman is in now, and Aldridge will take a shot at the big fella from Oregon on a runner, and Aldridge with a block. An offensive foul is called on the play.
Chapman's offensive foul. He left his feet. Aldridge did a great job on the block, and Morris did a great job coming in to set up the situation where he fouls right there. Texas 2-3 zone on out of bounds I really like, because that takes away almost any movement that they can get in an inbounds play.
Morningstar, Aldridge wants it against Pittman.
He's got to be a little bit quicker than he is with the ball right now. He's just taking a little bit too much time, Aldridge, when he gets the ball. He's got to get it, make a quick fake one way and go the other without putting it on the floor.
Here's Hamilton. He's not shy. Misses his first shot, whistled an air ball.
Hamilton doesn't have really good discretion as a shooter.
A three from Markeith Morris.
It's a nice, relaxed shot he had from the top of the key. Just stepped into the shot, had a little room.
His brother kneeling down in front of the scorer's table. He'll be checking back in. Johnson also going to return for the Horns.
You know, Texas got to get a little scoring from somebody other than James. James has got 8 of those 14 points, and nobody else has done much from the offensive standpoint. There's a double team again that takes Pittman away from going to the bucket.
Chapman missing the ball bay with a big rebound. Puts it back in Hamilton's hands.
Balbay, very tough kid. He does a lot of things on the floor. He's just not a very good shooter, and that takes a lot of pressure on the other four guys because they lay off of him.
Morningstar with a steal and a driving layup.
Morningstar did a very good job protecting the ball going into the bucket for that layup.
Markeith Fronty Pittman.
The ball screen is not real effective with Balbay coming off the ball screen, Brent, because he's not going to shoot the ball. So it's not imperative that the defensive man playing the screener steps out to help on Balbay, because he's looking for somebody to pass the ball to, not shoot it.
Reed picked up that foul. 14 fouls on the Longhorns and 5 on Kansas here in the first half. 9:07. Pittman, and Markeith held his ground.
Morris did a great job coming across and doubling up on the ball right there, and Pittman turned right back into him, and that's how he lost the ball.
Marcus tries to give it to his brother. Got it in a little bit too deep by the end line, went out of bounds.
That was a shot that Marcus should have taken. He made a really good move. Here we're going to see the pass goes into Pittman, and there's a great double team by Kansas that comes up on the pass right there, and they take away all the movement that Pittman had. I think it's almost imperative that when the ball goes to a strong postman, I don't care whether it's Morris or Pittman or Aldridge, who it is, that you get a second defender on that postman to keep him from getting a good move to the bucket. Well, there's a double team right there, and he's got to throw it back out.
And Pittman sails it back to Brown. Johnson for that high pick and roll. Brown keeps it on the dribble. Markeith rebounds, and here comes Sharon Collins. It's Marcus on a driving layup. Nice pass.
And also, you know, he did a great job of knocking the ball down and picking it up. Marcus did a really good job handling that pass. Collins is going to do a very good job bringing the ball down the floor. He's looking, makes the pass off, and Marcus handles it very, very well.
Well, a reminder that tomorrow's ESPN Super Tuesday features four teams in the top 20, SEC, Tennessee, and Vanderbilt. And then in the Big Ten, it'll be Purdue, Michigan State, and the Spartans certainly hoping that Kalen Lucas is able to return tomorrow. If the Spartans should be a loser again tomorrow night, and it is at home, and Coach Izzo's team is always tough there in East Lansing, but it would be some log jam if the Spartans are beaten by Purdue tomorrow night. And of course, on Saturday night, Spartans lost for the second straight time. Kalen Lucas unable to play. Tom Izzo telling the media today that it still was very tender, that ankle. He wasn't cutting real well, but it was better than it had been 24 hours ago. So we shall see tomorrow night. Here the Texas Longhorns trail the number one team in the nation by four.
Bradley, Brown, and Johnson have got to help Texas with the scoring burden a little bit, because James is still 8 of their 14 points, and he's just got to get some other people scoring.
Hamilton 0 for 2 here tonight. Bradley tracks it down.
They're going to set the ball screen here, and they're going to have to go with Brown because he can take it to the bucket.
Marcus Morris rebounds, and Sharon Collins on the far side.
Collins could have gone a little bit further with the ball screen there, and he would have wound up with Pittman on it.
He's got Marcus open. Low block left. Pittman's there. Henry.
Good pass out by Morris. He was in trouble in the post and made really good pass out for the bucket by Henry.
Hamilton with that quick shot again, and he doesn't do you a lot of help out when he starts to miss those shots. When he turns hot, then he can really help you, but not if he's off.
No, he's 0 for 3, and he's not going to stop shooting, that's for sure.
And here comes Aldridge to the free throw line. So the crowd is quiet here, Bob, because it is run by the Jayhawks.
Then this is where they have got to make a move coming out of this timeout.
Say you're on a call, and your friend wants to know,
what time's the movie?
You can tell him. And if your friend asks,
where's the theater?
You can show him. And if your friend says,
want to grab sushi afterwards?
You can do that too.
Great, on my way.
All without ever leaving the call. Can your phone and your network do that?
I'm Reese Davis, Sports Center right now, brought to you by Sprint. The Saints go marching back to New Orleans, back home after winning the Super Bowl after years of futility. Championship parade on Tuesday, 6 o'clock Eastern Time, 5 in the Big Easy. You can see it on ESPN News. The first of our rivalry week showdowns in the Big East. Villanova beat West Virginia on the road. Big game from Scotty Reynolds. Sports Center after the game. Stay current with ESPN News, Brent.
All right, Reese, thank you very much. Well, we are in Austin, Texas, which happens to be the hometown of one Drew Brees, the MVP of last night's great Super Bowl triumph over the favored Indianapolis Colts. He was born in Dallas and at age 7 moved here to Austin. And as a senior at Westlake High School right here, he led them to the Division V state football title before he played up at Purdue in West Lafayette, Indiana. And, of course, the students here raised money, bought a lot of T-shirts prior to the Super Bowl, and they're delighted at success as Cole Aldridge hits the first free throw. This is Westlake High School here earlier today, and the neon sign up there. Way to go, Drew. And there he is as a high school quarterback of the Westlake Chaparrals in 96-97. And Aldridge knocks down the second free throw. And Bob, as we take a look at the Longhorns team, they are 0 for their last 9 here.
They're 5 for 17 altogether, Brent. Now they've brought Lucas in the game as a guard. They've done a lot of moving with their guards. They brought Mason into the game also to see if he can help them with the offensive end.
Johnson misfiring, and so now they've missed their last 10. Loose ball. Here come the Jayhawks out with it. Here's Sharon Collins, a strong body, bringing it in. Scoop out of bounds. It'll be Jayhawk basketball.
You know, one thing I'll throw in about Drew Brees, you were talking about him. He's one of those athletes that had a real feeling for education and the school that he attended, Purdue. He and his wife have established an athletic center for the athletes relative to study with tutors and furthering their educations. And that's a great thing for a kid to do for his alma mater.
Yeah, he has really raised a lot of money for charities, not just in New Orleans. And Holly, I know right here at Westlake High School, those students raised money for Drew Brees.
Well, that's right. In fact, this was the T-shirt that they were selling that's got Brees' number on it. They sold over 1,800 of these T-shirts, raised $8,000. And you know what these kids did? They donated it to Drew Brees' foundation that is for needy children with medical hardships that do not have the money to pay for them.
Yeah, just wonderful things that the Brees family has done. Bob touched on it, and he's made major contributions up to Purdue University. And look at the sign that we have here, a playoff on the New Orleans Saints, of course. And Hoodats say they're going to beat the Longhorns right now. That Hoodats, the Kansas Jayhawks, 22-14, the number one team in the nation. And Taylor knocking down the three ball. Bob, I tell you, Kansas is the deepest team that I've seen in the country this year.
You just took the words right out of my mouth, because that's the first time Taylor has touched the ball in the game, and he really wasn't in a hurry. He had a lot of composure to what he did. He had good steps and drilled it with the three very first touch.
There's a timeout called by Texas. The Jayhawks are on a 17-0 run here. Wow. Well, we look ahead now to Wednesday and a couple of huge rivalries. Connecticut-Syracuse in the Big East. That'll start it off on ESPN at 7. Bob, I got to ask you about Duke and North Carolina. I got to ask you about the Tar Heels. Do you have any? I was looking at some of the preseason rankings, and almost everybody had them in the top 10 before the season started, and they may not even make the NCAA tournament this year. Do you have any feeling about the Tar Heels?
Yeah, first of all, a lot of preseason rankings are set up by people that have no idea what's going on. They don't have a clue to who can play and who can't play. We got to get that straight. Number two, when you lose as many good players as North Carolina did last year, I don't care who you are or where, you're in a really tough rebuilding season the next year.
But regardless, you can expect some strong emotion on that Wednesday night game. I believe that game is in Chapel Hill. They'll correct me if I'm wrong about that. And the crowd always ready for the Blue Devils. And here the Jayhawks, the recipient of another turnover. Sharon Collins like a defensive back, and he's rejected by James and Marcus Morris. Look what I've got.
Texas has got to move its offense up off the baseline, because they eliminate the best driving lanes on the floor when they play down low. And they've got to get up higher to give their offense more room in which to operate.
Sharon nails a three ball like an early dagger. I mean, they're pouring it on the horns early.
Boy, I'm telling you, if that one went in, there are going to be a lot of things go for the Jayhawks tonight.
You know, in watching them at practice, as we take a look at this, Bob, this is a group of basketball players who get along extremely well with each other. You know, as a coach, you could always tell the relationship among your players, and some of your teams got along better. It was interesting watching these fellows today at practice. This is a team very, very much together.
Any really good team, and you know this as well as I do, any really good team is made up of guys that are friends. It's made up of guys that want to help each other and play together. And that's and there's a lot of that comes from the coaching staff, from Bill Self himself, and from guys like Danny Manning that work with these kids.
And they've got talent, Henry and Marcus, morning star. Of course, you like him a lot. They bring Tyre Reed off the bench. He's on Brown now, and the Horns are just having a nightmare trying to get into their offense here.
Well, a huge key to this whole Kansas situation you mentioned a little while ago, and that's the depth. I mean, tremendous depth.
Nice defensive play by the Horns. And Johnson on the run. Can't get anything to fall. James is back. Aldridge rejects that. Battle on the floor. Here's Brown. Set three. No. Into Taylor's hands.
It's almost like the bucket has a lid on it right now for Texas.
4 minutes in the first half. This is 30-14.
And watch how they just move the ball from side to side. They try to attack on the right side. Now they'll bring it back over here to the left side and see what they've got. Aldridge moves.
Into Pittman's hands. Texas is 0 for its last 13.
And, you know, we've talked a lot about Aldridge. And think about this. This is a real strength that Kansas has. They've scored 30 points, and I think maybe Aldridge has two at this point.
The Horns trying to stop this 22-0 run, and they finally do as Damian James knocks down his third three ball of the night.
Well, he's got 11 of their 17 points, and they're just not getting anything from anybody else.
Blocked by Pittman again in underneath. And Markieff Morris is belted as we take a break here inside of 3 minutes.
You know, Morris did a great job going back into Pittman to draw that foul. It was really a good move on his part.
I'm Reese Davis. Coming up on the UPS Halftime Report, we'll show you what the secret was for Villanova as they went on the road against West Virginia. We'll put it under court vision. Digger and Hubert are here. We'll see you in just a few minutes, guys.
Hi, Reese. And here the Texas Longhorns went 11 minutes without scoring. Meanwhile, the Aggies, they're showing that they can play a little bit. Wins at Mizzou and versus Baylor. Kalen Lucas, will he be back tomorrow night against Purdue? We should find out. We're on the air at 9 Eastern on ESPN. And the Pac-10, we've talked about North Carolina having trouble. Pac-10 without a team in the top 25 for the fifth straight week. That is hard to believe. That's one of the six power conferences. And here is Markieff Morris, one of the twins at the free throw line.
The only thing that I've seen Kansas do that's negative tonight is that no matter who it's been in the post, they've been slow with the ball. They haven't caught it and faked and turned quickly. They put it on the floor. They've allowed some double teams. Had they been quick with it and completed, the score would be a lot worse than it is, if you can believe that. Texas has got to get stuff out of, as we mentioned, they got to get something out of Brown, Bradley. These guys have got to add something to Texas offense.
Matt Hill now on the floor, handling the ball for the first time.
Kansas does, as you mentioned earlier, Kansas is very quick, very active, and very focused defensively.
James open, and he's been the Horn offense here tonight.
There was the first real mistake Kansas has made defensively. They had a chance to switch, and they didn't get the switch, and that left James open. Well, this is where Collins takes a lot of time. He's patient. He looks to see which side of the floor to go to, and no matter which side he goes to, he's going to be dealing with somebody that can do something offensively.
James comes back, drives through, and scores again, and that's 15 for Damian James. Single-handedly trying to keep the Horns in this.
This actually, even with a 10-point lead, this is a big offensive possession for Kansas right here. This is a time where they got to do something to combat what James is doing. They're going to get a crack at the free throw line for two shots, I think.
Collins slipped on that ankle, and he's loosening his shoe here in front of me. And I think he's just maybe tightening that lace up on that right ankle. There was a slip when he came through, and I think this is the other ankle, actually, as I now look at it. Mm-hmm. Marcus Short.
In the early stages of the game, say the first 10 or 12 minutes of this half, everything was going Kansas' way. They were knocking the free throws down. They were getting to the bucket. And now they've missed a couple shots inside. They've allowed Texas to kind of creep back into at least a position where they can move into a situation where they have a chance to win the ball game. It didn't look like they were going to do that to start with.
Well, Bill Self and the coaching staff will need some player who can shut number five down, because he has been the horn offense here. Off to the left of the wing. And Brown takes it in, misses a shot. Rebound by Marcus Morris, and Shalon pushes the issue.
That was a really good help move by Aldridge that altered the shot, almost took away anything that would have been close to a good shot.
Back to Aldridge after the slash cut by Henry.
Now, even with Kansas with such a lead, to me, that was a very important bucket for Kansas to get back into the idea of scoring when they come down the floor.
Johnson wasn't ready, but he still controls it. Now Bradley's three, good. Good from the corner with a defender on him that time, too. Morningstar was there.
Now, that's the biggest contribution, getting set, getting the shot down, that Bradley made, that any guard for Texas has made in this game.
Yanked away, and here come the horns again. If they can get this down on this trip inside of 10 at the intermission, consider it an accomplishment.
Well, I think it's a huge accomplishment. And then Kansas, a little pressure is on Kansas then, because they've got to come out the second half, and they can't give them a couple of quick buckets to begin the second half.
So we've got a timeout, and a reminder again, tomorrow night we've got SEC action followed by the Big Ten. Let's talk about Tennessee taking on Vanderbilt in the SEC. And Bob, as you know, Tennessee is the only team to have defeated the Kansas Jayhawks this season. But I think you and I would agree that the one premier team in the SEC is still Kentucky.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question about that. I think that the SEC is not as strong with good teams as they usually are. Now, they have a lot of teams that are pretty even with one another, so it looks like this team can beat that team or that team beats this team, but they're just not that number three or four really good teams that the SEC sometimes has.
Meanwhile, here in the Big 12, there are a number of good teams, but the one dominant team in the conference so far has been Kansas. And with Cole Aldridge on the bench, Jayhawks lead it by 10 and 16 on the shot clock.
Well, you got to want to get it down under 8, so Kansas, whatever happens, Kansas doesn't have a chance to retaliate.
And Brown coming around Taylor. So there was a foul to give, and that's why he committed that personal. Shalon Collins comes back with 8.3 left.
You know, that was not a bad foul to commit, because Brown had gotten a step on the defense, and they've got fouls to give. They're not in Texas, not shooting a one and one, so stop him with a foul from getting to the bucket. That was a good move. They're going to do the same thing. They're going to leave it up to Brown.
Tap back by Markeith here. Shalon at the buzzer, midcourt. That's a shot he's practiced today earlier. And he got it up on the glass. He took a crack at it. Well, the first half trends. Led it 14-8. And then they went almost 11 minutes. Fell back 30-14 and finished on a 10-4 run. Let's go to Holly with Coach Self.
Well, Coach, you got out to a little bit of a slow start. Texas jumped up early, but what started to really click for your offense?
Oh, I don't know if it's offense. I just think we guard them really good. And we rebounded the ball decent. You know, if we'd have done a good job on Damian, you know, we'd be a little bit better shape now. He killed us. But we got the ball moving. We made him chase us a little bit.
What do you have to change with Damian James? He's got 15 early points.
Well, you know, he's made three threes, and we got to get to him quicker. He's going to score. We just got to do a better job and not let him get easy baskets off putbacks and in transition.
Thanks, Coach.
Holly, thank you. And so at the intermission, the coach of the number one team in the nation will go back to talk to the Jayhawks. Right now, let's join Reese Davis, Digger Phelps, and Hubert Davis, the UPS halftime report. Reese.
All right, Brent, so Collins and the Jayhawks up by double figures. It would be much more, as Brent said, if not for Damian James. In the first half, James has 6 of 9 shots from the floor. The rest of his Texas teammates, 3 for 19. So Bill Self has a pretty good idea who he needs to slow down in the second half. And they, as Bill said, they really thrived off their defense.
They thrived off their defense, Reese, because Kansas does so many different things defensively, especially when they force you to take bad shots like we saw. But part of that drought for 11 minutes was the turnovers. They end up, Texas, 9 turnovers, which led to 16 Kansas points in that first half. And you can't do that at home. You should be dominating what you want to do. Pittman was no factor in this half. 1 for 2, 3 points. And Morris and Aldridge's sides just really dominated the boards and allowed Kansas to get the transition points off turnovers. And this is why I think when you look at the biggest problem with Texas, their offense execution, Hubert, it's not there. They just don't get it done.
When you look for Texas offensively, the reason why they're struggling is because they're still trying to figure out their rotation. We have said over and over again that Rick Barnes has to pick 7 or 8 guys that he's going to play on a consistent basis. Here in the first half, they've played 11 players. That's too much. Now, look, in the second half, the 2 guys that need to play are Jacoven Brown, the point guard position, and Jordan Hamilton. Why? It's because defensively for Kansas, every time Texas is throwing the ball down low on the post to Dexter Pittman, they're double-teaming him. You need guys out on the perimeter that can knock down threes, put the ball on the floor, make a play, help Damon James on the offensive end. That is the lineup that needs to work for them, or they're going to continue to struggle, not only in the second half, but for the rest of the year.
We've already lost 4 out of 6. I think this is a huge game in terms of Texas confidence for the rest of the regular season, opportunity to turn things around at home against the number 1 team. If they're elite, they need to prove it in the second half. Still to come on the UPS Halftime Report, we'll put the court vision on how Villanova tried to climb the mountain.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Cisco. Welcome to the Human Network.
Famous. So to thank you, we're making any regular footlong a $5 footlong. Get that? Any regular footlong piled high with flavor, $5. Join the celebration.
This halftime report is delivered by UPS. Seize new opportunities at ups.com/whiteboard.
Brady Morningstar and the Jayhawks scored 22 consecutive points. You'd think it'd be a blowout, but Texas hanging around second half in the Horns' house. Number 1, still up by 10, 34-24 at the half. Time to put court vision on the first game that we had in rivalry week, West Virginia and Villanova. You know, guys, we've played over 4,000 college basketball games this season. First time we've had a top 5 matchup. Got a feeling we're going to have a lot more the rest of the way. Huggy Bear, don't know if he had dress pants for this game. Didn't have them in New York earlier. Taylor King got a shot blocked. Look at King. King didn't score, but he really made a contribution. Came up and found Isaiah Armwood.
Well, he did a terrific job off the bench. You mentioned him's 3-point shooting. Didn't score, but he had 8 rebounds at the power forward position.
Scotty Reynolds forced a turnover. Deshaun Butler doesn't really react quickly. And here's Dominique Cheek.
That's the breakaway. They love transition, and they just wear you down with their bench going up and down the floor.
Nova up by 9 later in the first half. This is a sensational steal by Reynolds, and watch the 2-on-1. Reggie Redding finishes. West Virginia has some pants on the ground, pants on the ground. Villanova up 44-33. Devin Ebanks had a very good defensive game, goes strong there, and here come the Mountaineers. Later in the second, 5-point game, Ebanks gets it, gets the dunk.
Ebanks had a great game, did the job he's supposed to, 13 points, 6 rebounds, but no Butler, only 1 point in the second half.
Scotty Reynolds, pull up, knocking down the jumper. He had 19 in the second half, and Hubert then finds Pena.
Well, he's one of the best players in the country. Not only can he shoot the basketball, he's a complete guard. Finds Pena underneath for the easy dunk and also penetrate. He got to the free throw line 10 times in this game.
82-75, Villanova bounces back from its first and only conference loss of the season after losing to Georgetown by winning on the road against West Virginia. Scotty Reynolds did what senior guards ought to do.
Well, what's amazing about Villanova when you look at their balance? In the first half, there's just nine guys that score, and Scotty Reynolds was the ninth guy to score. He had a layup, the only 2 points in the first half. But with 13 minutes to go in the game, this is when Scotty Reynolds has his M.O. He takes the game over. Whatever he likes to do, he gets it done. Whether if it's assists or fast breaks, he ends up with 19 of his 21 points with 13 minutes to go in the game. He goes 10 for 10 in the free throw line, and this is why they get it done with Scotty Reynolds on that floor when it's time for leadership.
Let me take you to the next level with Scotty Reynolds. By defender in the game against the Mountaineers, when Devin Ebanks was on him, West Virginia controlled him quite well these 37 possessions when Ebanks started the possession guarding Reynolds. The other possessions, 28 of them, that's when Reynolds got off for 17 of his 21 against someone not named Devin Ebanks. But Villanova, not just Reynolds, not just the starters, they've just got incredible depth.
That's one of the reasons why I love this team, and I feel like that they're going to go to a Final Four and have an excellent chance of winning a national championship is because they have a quality bench. This is a team that can play 10 or 11 guys, and when they bring those guys off the bench, tremendous versatility. On the year, they averaged 23 points off the bench. They had 17 in the first half. You've got big guys like Isaiah Armwood and get points in the paint. Taylor King, he didn't score tonight, but he had 8 rebounds, and you'd have Malik Waynes at the point guard position, another guard that can put the ball on the floor, knock down perimeter jump shots. That is going to be the key. When you always look at great teams, good teams this year, Kentucky, Syracuse, all of them have quality depth. Villanova shaping into a team that can get back to a Final Four and maybe this time get it done, win a national championship.
What I really liked, I liked the way they answered that loss. They came out with
played
fire,
great defense.
A lot of passion. Guys off the bench played with a lot of passion as well. And looming on the Villanova schedule on the horizon is Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh stepping out of Big East play on this night, taking on Robert Morris, and Ashton Gibbs is having a sensational season.
Gibbs is amazing. They struggled early in this game before they blew it out in the second half. But you know, Pittsburgh has what? Big East flavor, and that guy can flat out coach Jamie Dixon.
77-53, the winner, Butler. They've won 13 in a row. They're unbeaten in the horizon. Same deal for Siena and the Metro Atlantic. Though Fairfield, the Stags gave them a tussle.
This halftime report is delivered by UPS. Seize new opportunities at ups.com/whiteboard.
All right, now that the economy has changed, let's fine-tune your business to take advantage of new opportunities. Well, UPS can help lower warehouse costs while increasing your global reach. More UPS technology can help bring down paperwork. And UPS has more shipping options than anyone. Hey, it's time to seize the opportunities with UPS. There, now that sounds perfect.
Welcome back to the UPS Halftime Report.
Rivalry week for the women as well on ESPN2 right now. Second half just underway. Vanderbilt has a 1-point lead on number 5 Tennessee. Vanderbilt men play the Tennessee men tomorrow. And Duke destroyed North Carolina on the women's side. Joanne P. McCauley's team winning 79-51. The Carolina and Duke men play Wednesday night on ESPN. Sherron Collins and the Jayhawks rocking and chalking in the first half and knocking down the 3. 10-point lead for KU. Second half's around the corner.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Cisco. Welcome to the Human Network. And Acura. Acura Advance.
Back to ESPN's Big Monday, presented by Bud Light. It's part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco on ESPN. Halftime score, 34-24. And as you take a look at our Cisco game track tonight, you can see that this is the lowest scoring half of the season for the Texas Longhorns. Fewest points in the first half. Eight players were used, seven with a field goal. Meanwhile, on the other side, 12. And Coach Knight, I want to ask you, Hubert Davis has said this in a couple of times we've done Texas games, that he thinks Rick Barnes is using too many players and not settling on five and going with them. Well, what's your feeling about that?
Well, obviously he hasn't found five that he can go with in practice, let alone in games. And I think that you've got to keep using guys. Now, they've got no play whatsoever from the guards in the first half. Bradley hit a three, and that's the only contribution that the guards made in that whole half. He's got to keep looking and looking until a guard gets a better feel for what's going on offensively than his guards have right now. I don't blame him for continuing to use guys to try and find something. They're obviously going to have to do that to have a balanced offensive attack, one that can beat a team like Kansas.
And now, Holly, I see that Jacobin Brown is going to start the second half for the Longhorns.
Well, not only that, but he's gone back to Doge Valbe as well. And, guys, he was very frustrated when I caught up with him in the hallway. He's like, Holly, our offense, we just can't get it moving. So we're going to go back to what our team knows. That's Damian James inside. Dexter Pittman used the two big guys down low and have the guards try to get something going. But he said, we're not moving the ball. We're not screening. And we've got to make that extra pass to try to get guys open. But he's been trying to feel his way out and find guys who are going to step up and perform. That's why he's using so many guys. But nobody's really shown that they're ready to take on that role yet.
And Holly, they start the second half with a turnover. So here come the Jayhawks, the number one team. Over the top, Collins. Beautiful finish by X. Henry.
You know, that first bucket in the second half would have been very important for Texas because that's really going to pump them up, get them going, start the second half. And they didn't even get a possession out of it because of the turnover.
Shoot the baseline, and Bradley is fouled off in the corner. Henry. That's his first foul. 12-point advantage.
Bob. Texas just doesn't want to let Kansas, and you know, they don't, I don't mean to let, but Kansas, they can't allow Kansas to score here to start the second half with two or three buckets because that's going to be, put them in a huge, huge hole.
Ball knocked out of bounds. They've turned it over again.
Well, they've had two possessions and haven't had a chance to score yet, Texas.
Texas down to one timeout. Kansas with three. Check four for Kansas.
Good help on the drive there. Henry got in a little bit too deep. He should have taken that shot from about 12 feet.
Pull up by Bradley. Off the iron. Aldridge is knocked down underneath. He was mugged. That's on Valbe. That's his first. So Doge picks up number one, and not a positive start here for the Longhorns. Turn the ball over, commit fouls.
I've been kind of surprised that Kansas hasn't gone to Aldridge a little bit more inside. And that was a tough pass to make. Good defense on that back cut. But Aldridge, down low, hasn't had really much of an opportunity to score. A little bit early in the game, but not much here after the first 5 minutes of the game. And I think he would do a lot of damage if he got some touches inside.
They were discussing who the ball went off of, and you can see this cut through. And
no, that was a really good call right there. They were right on top of that. And it was not a good pass. It was just too tight of a connection to try and make on that back cut.
Pittman in the low block, and on the entry pass, foul is called on Aldridge. That's his second. And he'll come out. And now both Morrises, as Markeith replaces Aldridge. Marcus, who dislocated a finger and has been in the game, number 22. And Pittman is handled by Markeith. Head pass, here comes Henry rolling in again. That's nine for the freshman from Oklahoma City. His daddy played a couple of years. Larry Brown up in the 80s. Here's Bradley coming in. It's off Pittman's hands and saving it. Ball back. Bradley missing. And it's handled by Markeith. Over now to Sherrod. Swoops in on the play, knocked out of bounds. James is there and he's on the floor.
Kansas is really on the brink of taking complete charge of this game right now, Brent, unless Texas can get a bucket and at the same time prevent Kansas from scoring here.
Fans are sitting on their hands. That's how the Jayhawks have taken the crowd completely out of this. Morningstar regains his dribble. Now it hits Henry, slashes it over to Markeith, who's fouled and he'll shoot. A frustrating night here, Bob, for the Longhorns in Austin.
Well, Kansas is just getting the ball into better positions offensively than Kansas or than Texas is. Kansas has had the best of offensive positioning there, where they can draw a foul. On each possession that Kansas has had here in the second half, they've either scored 2 points or had a chance to score 2 points, and Texas is 0 for 4 possessions right now. That's a 5-0 start for Kansas in the second half, and Texas just cannot afford that. They've got to really get back into this.
After their lowest scoring first half of the season.
The problem they have with Balbay handling the ball a lot is they're not going to have to guard him as a shooter. He's going to try and drive and make something happen with his drive and be able to pass the ball, but they just haven't been able to get it into position yet with Kansas defense. There was Balbay with the turnover.
Almost. Get it in neat. James put back. And the Longhorns finally come away with a score here in the second half. Their first hoop is Johnson. Collins shaking up.
I think Collins might have gotten cracked in the sternum or cracked in the stomach a little bit, because it seems to be something that's affected his breathing a bit. Now he's back.
Great all-around high school athlete in Chicago. He's built like a football player. When you watch him, you think you're looking at a linebacker out here.
Well, this is a good possession defensively for Texas. They're very active. Now Aldridge is going to get a chance at a three here.
So that is the third foul on Damian James.
If they take Pittman's coming in, if he's coming in for James, that's with three fouls. I believe at this point, Brent, I'd just leave James in the ballgame. You're 14 behind. You can be 14 behind here. Kansas' major weakness, if they've had one in this game, has been at the free throw line. They've missed a lot of points from the line.
Damian will take a break. Could have been a violation.
I think now we're going to see, with James out of the ball game, this could be a very fatal thing for the Longhorns, but I think we're going to see the Texas guards really take a look at trying to score, particularly Bradley and Brown. I think they're going to try to take over the scoring here.
And because of the violation, Aldridge shoots a second one again, which he nets, and that costs the Horns a point. 40-26, 16:32 to go. Ever since 3 weeks ago, the Texas Longhorns were unbeaten and ranked number one. They have lost 4 of 6 since then, as Brown, a left-handed shot. It's his second field goal of the night.
Brown did a really good job splitting the defense right there, and Kansas did not move to help at the end of that drive.
Pittman leaning on Aldridge, and they didn't send the ball into the post. Now knocked out of bounds away from Sherrod Collins. So we'll take a break. And Sherrod Collins a little bit frustrated that no help came out his way. We'll take a break.
on Syracuse, then Duke versus North Carolina, Wednesday on ESPN.
If you could sign these so I can... Okay, but they need to be signed
Looks
before...
Looks like someone got some flowers.
It's for me or her? I'm just kidding.
Who sends flowers in a box? That's the same thing cigarettes and dead people come in. Is he your cousin, or did you meet him in prison?
This Valentine's Day, don't send flowers in a box. You never know what they'll say. Teleflora's bouquets are hand-arranged, hand-delivered in a keepsake vase. That's the Teleflora difference.
There's a lot of nice guys in prison.
Don't touch me.
All-you-can-eat pancakes are back at IHOP, starting at $4.99. The value you've always known us for is now even better. All day, every day at IHOP. Come hungry, leave happy.
Austin, Texas, capital of the state of Texas. And here tonight, the Longhorns struggling against the Kansas Jayhawks. And, Coach, let's go inside the play.
Here we're going to look at the start of the second half. And this is where Texas has really got to clamp down defensively. And they get an over-the-top lob pass for a bucket. Kansas does. And they're going to come right back with a block shot and a little breakaway here that gives them the first 4 points of the second half. Now, Texas has got to overcome that 5-0 lead that Kansas had to start the half before they can even make a dent into what the halftime score was, with Kansas up by 10 or 12 at the half.
Collins drives it, and Pittman knocks it out of bounds. Still 9 on the shot clock for the Jayhawks.
It's going to be a foul.
So Sharon Collins able to draw the foul. I thought it was a rejection by Pittman. No argument. So he must have made a lot of contact with his body down there. And they're going to say that it was ball bay.
Boy, Pittman really got up on top of him. But it must have been, as you said, it must have been ball bay that hit him on the way to the basket. Because I thought Pittman was way on top of the ball. Right there, the hand on by ball bay, maybe the body. That must have been called just before the
that
shot.
That was a Pittman total eclipse. I never even saw ball bay.
That's a really good two for Kansas right there. You know, they keep it, they're ahead in this half. If you win the first half and win the second half, you're going to win the game. How's that for brilliant? No,
that's
comment?
Really, that's brilliant.
Now they found Pittman, but Aldridge is tough for Pittman to go against inside.
Wow. Aldridge really did a job defensively. Markeith now in the game.
This is going to be a score by Aldridge. Nope, he let it slip out of his hand. Made a little quicker move, but.
Went to the left hand that time.
Yeah.
The Horns are in need of some firepower here. Only 28 points against this Jayhawk defense. Driving underneath, no loose ball, and foul. A foul is going to be called.
Oh, a walk. Now there again was Aldridge defensively. Just his presence and his hand up in the air was a real deterrent to the layup attempt by Texas on that possession. I'm surprised that Taylor hasn't played a little bit more. No, he's back in. He's the guy that came in for Henry. All right, now watch how Collins lays off of ball bay. Now Collins can really help inside.
And a foul before the travel this time.
Yep.
And that's on Markeith Morris. That's his second. That is his second. 14:41 to go.
See Collins is completely playing off ball there.
Aldridge with the block. That's his third block of the night. Taylor back quickly. And here's Sharon. Didn't drain it off Aldridge's hands. Ball out of bounds.
I think it went off Texas' hands. Aldridge fumbled a little bit, and I think Texas slapped it out of bounds.
ships it back to Cole. Ball plays on Sherrod's. Great spin move inside. Ball knocked out of bounds.
With great help. That's the second time Pittman has seen the drive start at the foul line and move to cover the drive. Here is the spin. Pittman moved extremely quickly into the driver's path.
Deep pass to Taylor. In and out, and Markeith comes right back. Finally, the Longhorns clear it out.
Kansas having a little bit of trouble finding the net right now, as Texas did through the first half.
Johnson is fouled. Hit on the elbow. Markeith, that's his third. Four team fouls on Kansas and four also on Texas here.
Now, Johnson has not been over the season a real good free throw shooter, but he's got to at least come away with one here.
You know, you said one way to solve the free throw shooting problem, don't get fouled. They've only shot four throws here tonight.
But from a defensive standpoint, if they're not shooting well from the free throw line, foul them every time down the floor. Let them shoot free throws. They need this. Oh.
42-29.
Now, Texas can really get good pressure on Reed and Morningstar in here now, and it looks like they're definitely going to do that, and that will be a hindrance to Kansas' offensive movement. Collins is a lot more difficult to pressure than Reed and Morningstar are. Very good defense by Texas.
Marcus is rejected by Pittman. That's his third block of the day.
You know, third in a row, actually. He's come over to help out three straight times on the block. Here he comes and does a really good job of going up. When you're going to be a blocker, you got to do it with your hand and your arm. You can't do it with your body. Your hand and arm have to be in front of your body. They have to lead you into the block so you don't commit a foul.
What was interesting is they gave him about a 10-second blow. He walked over toward Barnes. Barnes pointed at him to go back, and he's back on the floor. Now they'll take Johnson out. Morningstar out of six on the shot now. And they turn it over. They're trying to knock it out of bounds off James. James cut in underneath it, and they give it back.
Huge turnover.
Reed inside.
Nope.
Into Pittman's hands. Pittman wants it on Aldridge, and Aldridge rejects it. And back comes Morningstar. Headman numbers, Taylor Rowland. That was a big moment. It looked like the Horns might dig back in this affair, but they're stuck on 29 here at 12 and a half minutes. James will try the three and knocks it down.
Now see, that's really sloppy defense on Taylor's part. You know, James just walked right into the shot. Taylor just said, go ahead and shoot. Well, that's his fourth three. After three, you'd think you'd really get into somebody.
But it is the first time he scored this half. So Kansas has done a better job on James. You know, as badly as the Longhorns have played, folks, they're still in this game.
Well, they will be if they can just keep it going and come.
I'm Reese Davis, SportsCenter right now, brought to you by Sprint. Danica Patrick will race in the Nationwide Series at Daytona on Saturday. She makes her NASCAR debut. Her first practice Wednesday, 3 o'clock Eastern on ESPN2. You'll be able to see it then. Villanova beats West Virginia, top five matchup in the Big East on Big Monday in rivalry week. Scotty Reynolds had 21. SportsCenter after the game. Stay current with ESPN News.
Well, here at halftime, the Longhorn football team, coached by Mack Brown, was honored. The youngsters were out in the middle of the floor. They're hoisting the Big 12 championship trophy, which they won. I wonder if Mack Brown would ever open the second half with an onside kick or if he has. Interestingly enough, that punter, Thomas Morstead, who pulled that off last night, is from SMU. That's where he went to school. First time in his competitive life that he's ever tried an onside kick. What a time for it. And here the Jayhawks with a 12-point lead. And the Horns are trying to dig in defensively. And Aldridge, James got it. It goes up on top. And it looks like it was deflected. And it will be Jayhawk basketball. And it was blocked. So take a look at this. Double team coming in behind. And 13 on the shot, coach.
You know, going to Texas for just a moment. Texas has had six guards score 7 points in 50 minutes of playing time. They've just got to get more out of it. I don't care whether they're playing Kansas or who. They've just got to be better with what they get out of that. Marcus, out of that guard play.
Yeah, Marcus Morris gets one to bounce in. So let's check this guard play out. Ball Bay, as you said early in the game, he's not a scorer. And they've tried Brown out here on top. Lucas was out there for a time. Hamilton checks back in now. There's Balbe kicking it back outside. Hamilton won't be shy. He'll try a few passes, but not too many. Here's Balbe, and he puts it like a turnover, and Pittman picked it up, and a foul is going to be called. So we will take a break, and the Longhorn fans are here in abundance tonight, hoping that they can dig back in against the number one team in the country, the Kansas Jayhawks. 11:28 remaining, and Cole Aldridge has picked up his third foul. Jayhawks lead it by 14. Bob, let's talk about block shots.
Well, you know, we've got a lot of shot blockers out here in this game for both sides. And the whole key to the block shot is to go up in the air with your body away from the shooter so that they can't get you for a body foul. There's a perfect example where Pittman keeps his body away, blocks it with his hand, and then Aldridge does the same thing. In both cases, when the hand touched the ball, the body was probably a full foot to 18 inches away from the offensive shooter's body.
So with Aldridge on the bench, the Horns will see if they can make some offensive pay here. Balbe is in the game. Johnson, Bradley, James with a pick for Balbe, who gets into traffic, puts the ball down. It goes over to the Jayhawks. They continue to have turnover problems. That's 14.
Well, Balbe went into a real hornet's nest there. He took the ball inside, too far inside. That's a problem that they have, is because he is not going to shoot the ball from 16 or 17 feet. And they've got to have a guard out there that can hit that shot.
What a luxury when Aldridge is out with a little bit of foul trouble. The two Morrisons are out here. This is Marcus rolling it in out there with his brother Markeith.
You know, Marcus saw the opening and took advantage of it. That wasn't just a dribble toward the bucket. That was a definite opportunity to get to the basket.
Chance for a three by Johnson. Good pass by Damian.
James makes a very good move to the bucket. And going up where he's probably going to get the shot blocked is athletic enough to make the move over to Morris and over to Johnson, and put him on the free throw line.
Missed the free throw. Tracked down. Markeith saved it. And here's a 14-point advantage. About 10 and a half minutes. Sharon Collins. Boy, the Jayhawks have got some weapons. Here's Markeith Morris. Ball fake. Sharon wide open. That would have been a Bob Knight special.
Oh, I'd have jumped up and clapped on that one.
He's got it back. Here he comes. Gives it to anybody underneath. That was 4-0. And Marcus slams it home.
Just a real careless play on Texas at the opposite end.
They have not protected the ball. They have not shot well. And there's a foul over the back. That's on Markeith Morris, and that is number 4 on number 21. That will send Aldridge back into the game. Number 45 is up. It's a somewhat tight rotation that Bill Self has, Bob. And as you know, as the season rolls along in February, you get into the dog days of conference play, but you start looking ahead toward the tournaments, Big 12 tournament, then, of course, the NCAA. You keep that rotation right where it is. And Bill Self and that coaching staff, they really have an idea of who they want on the floor at any given time.
This is a time in the year, Brent, when practices get shorter and shorter and shorter, because that energy that you expend in practice at this time is going to be needed for the ends of games. And I think both of these teams are well aware of that, but Texas has got to do a lot more work.
And Morningstar nails the three ball for the Jayhawks. And Holly, it's an interesting plan that Self has for the Jayhawks.
Well, you know, we talk about people being ranked number one and if they have a target on their back, and he's taking a very different approach. He's embracing it and saying, we want to play as good as a number one team should play. But he wanted to take it a little step further. Last night in a team meeting with his whole group of guys in front of everybody, he went through each guy individually and said, I need you to collectively, in your individual game, get 10% better, and here's what I need you to do. And he told guys in front of each other so they can hold each other accountable. I asked Sharon Collins what his was, and he said, keep everybody on the same page. Be the eyes of Coach Self on the floor. Cole Aldridge said, don't get into dumb foul trouble. And Xavier Henry said, I got to know when to be aggressive. He's still not quite sure when he has the autonomy to step up and score in this offense. I'd say they're 10% better, guys, if the score is in any indication.
Agreed. 9:20 here. Hamilton tried to draw an Aldridge foul. Didn't get the whistle. Slashing through, and there's a foul on the Longhorns. When you think about the success of this team, here is how they rank overall against everybody in their scoring margin. They beat teams by better than 20 points a game, although that has, I want to point out, that's dropped off considerably since Big 12 play began. And those numbers take into account the non-conference games. It's been a little bit tougher going. Remember now that Colorado and Kansas State have both taken them into overtime, and that stays down for Aldridge, Coach.
Collins made a really good play there. He got caught on a drive, got doubled up on the drive, and yet was able to make a really neat little backhand pass to Aldridge. Brown, a few times, and this is a guy we've mentioned a couple of times that Rick Barnes thinks has really got to be a key to the future of this team, both this year and beyond. Now, he has made better plays, but not very frequently, however, than any other guard has made in this ball game for Texas.
Well, it is clear when you talk about the number of players that he uses. Aldridge comes up, tap back up, no. Say that, Bob, it is clear that your point is well taken. He's using three different point guards because he can't find one. Knocked away by Aldridge. And a clean block again. Henry was down low. Here's Collins. Morningstar run a little time.
Morningstar made a good move there. Usually that would be a situation where he or Reed might take the shot. But Morningstar very conscious. The clock kind of running down a little bit here. Got rid of it and used up some time.
And here's Henry. Not there. James rebound. James has been the best overall player tonight for the Longhorns.
Oh, by far. He made a really good block out on Aldridge there, enabling him to go up and get the ball.
On the drive by Brown, left-handed. There's another good move by Brown. And perhaps we're watching a point guard finally emerge this year for the Horns. 8 points now for number 50.
You know, that drive, good drive, but anytime there's a drive from on top that scores, there's a lack of help from inside in the defense. And Brown was able to get to the bucket, and Kansas reacted as poorly to the drive as they have on any defensive possession tonight.
Now, Bob, we've got 7:14 left here, and if the Horns are going to make a move, they've got to gather themselves. As we remind you now, Wednesday night, Connecticut and Syracuse. I'm going to ask you about Hughes here in a minute, followed by Duke and North Carolina, because I want everybody to hear what you tell me, that you think on a given night when they play well, that Syracuse might be the best team in the country.
You know, I really believe that. I think their zone defense is being played. That 2-3 zone that Jim Boeheim uses is better this year than it has been in some time, and it's always been pretty good, but it's very good this year. They do a really good job with their offense because they can score from the outside, score from the inside. When they play well, which they have done far more than not, I just believe they're the best team in the country. The team that would be closest to them would be Kansas.
Bob, we're going to take a look at the tournament resume of North Carolina, and certainly it is starting to sag. It is brought to you by the Ladders. Their overall record now, 13-10. But look at their conference record, 2-6. They've lost six of their last seven games. You're going to see them Wednesday night. And if Roy Williams and the Tar Heels are going to gather themselves, it could begin against Duke Wednesday night. Taylor on a run, not there. And here's X underneath, the freshman. Got it back again, coming on the third attempt. The Jayhawks put it down.
Henry did a really good job in there against Texas big men. He little pause, little head fake, and then made the move.
Brown coming in.
He drew a foul on the drive that time.
You know, Brown penetrating move is the most effective penetrating move they've got with their guards.
Well, you know, when he does penetrate, though, he's got to be able to find somebody that's open also, and that's what a guard driving the ball has got to be able to do.
Time out.
How can rice production in India affect wheat output in the U.S., the shipping industry in Norway, and the rubber industry in South America? At T. Rowe Price, we understand the connections of a complex global economy. It's just one reason over 75% of our mutual funds beat their 10-year Lipper average. T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. Request a prospectus or summary prospectus with investment objectives, risks, fees, expenses, and other information to read and consider carefully before investing.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Bud Light. With a just right taste that's not too heavy, not too light, the difference is drinkability.
'57-40, the number one team in the country, leading by 17. Well, there's a lot of great ex-Longhorns here, a couple of golfers. There's Tom Kite, living right here in Austin, and remains a loyal Longhorn fan. Ben Crenshaw, another one in attendance here tonight. One thing about the loyalists, they haven't headed for home, partner. They haven't given up.
No, that's a great sign. It's a sign of fans that appreciate what these kids have done, what the team is trying to do, and they know they're struggling. And I think that's a wonderful thing for the Texas fans to be able to come out like this and stay with this team with its struggles.
Brown at the free throw line, knocks it down. 6:47. Certainly still possible, but they've got to be able to score the basketball. They can't do anything if they don't knock down field goals.
You know, they've just had three buckets this half, but the thing that they may be coming up with is Brown as a guard. Now they've got to just come right back with him and practice this week and try to build on what he's done out here today, because he has been the most effective guard by far that they've used.
Mason, seeing his first game action, did not start tonight. And there is Marcus Morris coming back again.
You know, Texas defense has been pretty good. Now, they've got beat on a couple of over-the-top lobs and a couple of offensive rebounds. But basically, they've done a pretty good job, particularly on the perimeter, against Kansas.
James with a strong offensive rebound, drives back in, and he's fouled. It's on Morningstar.
I think one thing, talking about players and trying to get a lineup that can do offensively something for you. Rick may be playing Mason now because he has such a great allegiance to the team, but I think I'd want Brown and Bradley in there at the guards right now. Both of them can shoot the ball. Both of them can contribute maybe more to the offense than any of their other guards. And I think here comes Bradley now. I wonder who he'll come in for. that I would like to see. Yeah, that's what they're going to do. I would like to see Bradley and Brown finish out the game at the guards, because that's what Texas needs.
If James hit this free throw, it's a 20-point night.
Well, and that's about, if he hits it as he did, that is close to 50% of the team's output offensively, and they still have just the three buckets this half.
6 minutes to go. Collins goes down, and Bradley fouled him. Tripped him up.
When you're out on the floor like that playing somebody as quick as Collins, you don't want to get caught tight to him. You want to get off of him a little bit and then let him come dribbling back into you. You get into him too tight, all of a sudden he's got a half a step, which becomes a full step on you, and now he's going to the bucket where help has to come, and he's so good at getting rid of the ball. Just don't need to play Collins that tightly out on the floor.
Missed a spot. Sharon was right there. Let's get it dried up.
You know, the best guy we've seen with the broom so far this year has been Aldridge.
Remember that night up in Lawrence?
Yeah.
Ships it into Collins, and here we go. 5.5 minutes. SportsCenter will be coming up next. Recap as the Saints return home, and Sharon Collins takes it home for the Jayhawks.
There, Texas just didn't come over to help. Sharon Collins is going to beat most guys out on top. And the only way to keep him from getting to the bucket is coming from the side to come in to take that driving line away from him and make him throw the ball out to the sideline. And you're going to see it right here where Collins starts out. He gets a half a step, now a full step, and nobody comes over. Just a hand that reaches out at him right here instead of somebody coming over to do something. We got the wrong end of the court there, but it really was the same thing. Brown drew the foul, and Kansas did not get help on the drive.
Aldridge leaves with his fourth personal. So the Morris brothers are together again on the floor, and for Brown, I wouldn't be surprised if he doesn't see more and more playing time here for the Longhorns, just based on how he has played and trying to help the Horns come from behind against the Jayhawks. We shall see.
Now, this is where they're going to get in foul trouble again.
Collins gets it away to Morningstar. Pull up Jay off the front of the iron, and here comes Bradley. Headman now, and here's Brown on the wing. Brown slashes basket. He's got a field goal. Mark it down. He's going to see more and more minutes for this team.
Well, he has to, because not only has he made some buckets in this game, but he is a good free throw shooter, and he's gotten to the foul line. I repeat again, Texas has done a pretty good job defensively. It's their offense combined with Kansas defense that has kept them so far out of this ball game.
Out of bounds, Morningstar was. Brown will take it out of bounds on the far side. Jacobin, freshman out of Port Arthur, Texas, played at Memorial High School in Port Arthur.
Taylor's back in the ball game, Brent, for Morningstar, and that gives them just a little more quickness on the floor. Texas perimeter defense has been very good in this half, and Kansas has not gotten the ball to the bucket as much as they did earlier, but now Taylor will help that a bit.
Oh, Brown drained a huge three. Back within 10 and 4.5 to go. Pressure in the backcourt. Brown has ignited this rally. Aldridge has got to come back in with four fouls. Sharon Collins, not this time, but underneath, and a block by James. Ball loose. Markeith with a huge hoop.
Well, that was a huge break for Kansas getting that bucket, because this crowd's about to erupt if Texas gets one more bucket. A very poor shot taken by Collins, but Kansas really stays after it inside and comes up with an opportunity for a three.
Now Markeith with a chance for the old-fashioned three.
And the Jayhawks needed that output. They make the most of an opportunity. And Markieff will sit down. Aldridge with four fouls back on the floor.
That score for Kansas, Brent, I think is the biggest score of the game thus far. It prevented them, the Longhorns, from getting under 10 and maintain that lead for Kansas.
Brown missed the driving, and there's an elbow thrown by Aldridge.
You know,
on James, and James rejects the apology.
Let me tell you something about that before we got a crowd going crazy here a little bit. That guy has got to give Aldridge room to move, and he didn't do it.
Let's take a look at what you're saying here now. And Barnes, of course, they want the flagrant, the crowd, obviously. Now watch. James made contact and actually put a saddle on him.
And again, James may have fouled him twice before Aldridge turned to clear the ball. I don't think there's a foul there at all on Aldridge's part.
And there's no question.
All right, now that the economy has changed, let's fine-tune your business to take advantage of new opportunities. Well, UPS can help lower warehouse costs while increasing your global reach. More UPS technology can help bring down paperwork. And UPS has more shipping options than anyone. Hey, it's time to seize the opportunities with UPS. There. Now that sounds perfect.
I'm Reese Davis, SportsCenter in-game update. Magic taking on the Hornets, and Vince Carter just went off. 34 of his 48 in the second half. Former Nets legend, just three off his career high. 51 as Magic rallied from a 17-point deficit to beat New Orleans, 123-117. Plenty on SportsCenter coming up in a bit.
Well, here are the officials are explaining to the coaches what they've decided after they went over to the monitor to take a look at Aldridge clearing out after James had been called for the foul. And it is obvious that Self is not happy with the decision that has been made by the officials. Now I'm going to show you this replay. And again, I want to point out that as James puts a saddle on Aldridge, the foul is clearly called by the official. Then Aldridge spun the elbow out. James rejected the apology. Obvious contact down there. And got the elbow around. And now the officials have come over, and they have looked at the monitor. Fourth foul, James. And a technical foul has been called on Cole Aldridge. So he has fouled out of the basketball game with a 13-point Jayhawk advantage here. And Holly, your take on the other side, you could hear it much better than we could.
Well, why Bill Self was so upset is his complaint was the same thing you guys were talking about, is that James did not give Aldridge room to move. He was sitting on his back, and that's why he was so upset. But just now when Rick Barnes came over to the huddle, he explained the call to Damian James and said, hey, don't be upset about it. He's fouled out anyway. What I want from you guys is I want you to go out and play good, clean, hard basketball. Play clean, but I don't want you to back down, and I want you to fight.
Well, he comes in with Morningstar.
I'm not sure I've ever seen that before.
What was this? He was shooting, and isn't it technical against Aldridge?
No, we got it. We got it. Now we're going to see Brown shoot two technical fouls on the technical. Morningstar was shooting a 1-1, and for some reason he completely lost his balance, stepped across the line, missed
the
shot anyhow.
And Brown
makes both of the technical. Now it's going to be Texas ball out of bounds.
Here it is, folks. This is one for the ages. Excuse me. Maybe I get it back in 5 minutes. They'll laugh about it later. Maybe not now. 64-53. 11 points. 3:43. Fight hard. Remember, that's what Barnes is telling him. James fighting to get into position here. And he does. Aldridge has fouled out of the game.
Oh, I'm not sure that's a foul in the act of shooting. That's a little bit liberal right there. You know, I think on that play, you've either got the shot or you've got the foul, one or the other, but I don't think you have both on that play.
22 points here tonight for Damian James, and he is 2 of 3 so far at the free throw line, and he makes an old-fashioned three.
Now, this is where Collins just can't make any mistakes handling the ball. He's got to be very good with it and get to the free throw line because he will get fouled.
He sends it the Morning Star. Bring a time down off the clock, and the Horns are not moving on anybody yet. Taylor goes inside and he draws the foul, but didn't make the layup. He was more concerned about the foul than he was putting the layup in.
He really didn't have much of a chance to make that shot. Texas committed the foul, but they closed quick enough from the help side to take away any good attempt he has at a bucket.
Here we go. This is both of them. And Brown will bring it down for the Horns. And he's fouled, reaching by Taylor. And he's going to go the other way.
He caught the ball,
caught
on,
the
his
ball
hip.
On the hip.
Yeah.
Caught the ball on the hip.
Are you going to see him come across here? He's going to change direction. Right there, he caught the ball on his hip. So
very
it's a
good call.
It's a traveling violation.
No question.
I'd kind of think that Kansas would want Henry in the ball game in this situation, maybe other than Taylor. Oh, he is back in the ball game. Okay.
And here comes X on the drive, and he's fouled. He'll be on the free throw line. Javon Hyde, Super Tuesday features 4 teams in the top 20 on ESPN. 7 Eastern SEC, Tennessee and Nashville to take on Vanderbilt. And in the Big Ten, up in East Lansing, be up there for Purdue against Michigan State. And here comes Henry.
You know, Brent, I think we've talked about this 2 or 3 times, but I do think that Texas had played very well defensively. They've been tough to score against here in the second half. Kansas has gotten to the free throw line. They haven't shot real well from the free throw line. But if Rick Barnes, as a coach and his staff, can come out of this with a guard that can contribute offensively, as Brown has, and continue to put on the same pressure defensively, this game will end up being a plus for him.
Brown taking it to the rim and missing the driving layup. Now the Jayhawks back in control. Up 10 here. 2:30 to go.
Jump ball. Kansas ball.
The Kansas 14.
Markieff Morris will sit down, replacing him Tyrell Reed. Ron Collins wants to bring it up, and the Horns are somewhat reluctant to foul him. Gets it into Reed, and he pulls the trigger off the bench.
Reed did a really good job with a little head fake there, getting the defensive man going by him instead of getting a piece of the ball with a block.
Whipped inside to Johnson. Brown with a left-handed pass.
That's far and away the best pass that a Texas guard has made all night long. Now, Brown has played a half here, Brent, that probably is the best half that any Texas guard has played this season.
Well, they may have finally found that lineup that he's been searching for. Look at that. What a delivery. That's the delivery of the night.
And particularly from Texas guards. And as we've said all along, that has been a real problem for Texas in its offense, not necessarily its defense, because Baalbei is a very, very good defensive player. But he just doesn't give enough to them offensively. He's not a shooter, so that takes away his passing because they play so far off of him that he doesn't have any passing angles.
Well, the Jayhawks at both ends of the floor. 2:17 to go. Here you can see forcing one turnover after another. They have forced 17 turnovers, and they've scored 27 points off those 17 turnovers. So it has been defense leading to offense for the Jayhawks. And the leading scorer, Marcus Morris, with 16. Henry with 13. Those are the two Jayhawks in double figures. And, of course, for the Longhorns, Damian James tonight with 23. 23 of their 58 points here tonight. And from the floor, Kansas hitting 39.7% for the game, and Texas 35.8.
You know, Brown has averaged 19 points to that Texas total also, Brent. And along with turnovers, we need to mention assists. Kansas has an advantage in turnovers, 17 for Texas, 10 Kansas. But Kansas also has 14 assists, which means they've been distributing and passing the ball much better than Texas has.
Henry gets it across the timeline. Morningstar all alone over here at the two-minute mark. Johnson battling for the ball. Brown gambled, couldn't steal it. Collins brings the time down inside of 10. Now 1:51.
Scoring isn't nearly as important here as time.
Rebound by James. Yanks it down. And here comes Brown again. 1:39. The three from Hamilton off iron and into Morris's hands.
Coach Barnes was not real happy with Hamilton's shot selection there.
Now they spread the floor with 1:22. The Horns have not committed any deliberate fouls. And Bradley finally does on Sharon Collins. Here he is talking to Hamilton. Young man, a freshman out of Los Angeles. And somebody just has to learn about rhythm and in the context of things, and it'll come. We saw him the other night, Bob. You and I had him. And when he's shooting and he's on, he's a lights-out offensive.
His shot selection and how important is the shot that he takes to the offense at the moment that he takes it. He shoots quickly sometimes. He takes a shot where another pass or two is going to manufacture a much better shot.
So Sharon knocks it down, and Hamilton tonight is without a point. He's 0 for 5 from the floor. Somebody once said that that the Longhorns were in search of a leader, and sometimes they have too many kids who think they're the leader, but this young man right here, Jadovin Brown, has stood up here tonight and been very impressive as Hamilton jumps in and commits the foul on Taylor. They'll come up to the other end. So the number one team with a minute to go is going to stay number one, and this will extend the Kansas winning streak to 9 since that loss on the road at Tennessee.
You know, Kansas has really done a pretty good job of staying, having set up a pretty good distance between Texas and themselves in this ball game, even though they haven't been as effective in the second half as they were in the first half. They've maintained a good distance from the Longhorns throughout the entire ball game. There's been some moves by Texas to really reduce it to get back in the game, and I think each time Kansas has met that move and taken it away from Texas.
Into the corner, Bradley. Tap, loose ball, picked up underneath, and a foul is called, and I believe it James down hard. And there is Sharon helping him up. Sharon Collins from the Jayhawks. Teammate Brown. And Henry got in underneath him when he was up, so it's been a tough night underneath for Damian James.
I think this may be the most important single thing for Texas this entire season, and that's Brown's play. Now, the second most important thing is going to be if Brown can continue that play. And I don't expect him to continue the kind of scoring that he's had here in the second half throughout every game that he plays, but just what he's doing with the ball, the way he's handled the ball without losing it, the good decisions that he's made. His play, if he can continue it, is going to be extremely crucial to Texas being any kind of a contender at the end of the season.
Well, I'll tell you, when you talk about somebody who delivered tonight for Kansas, it has been Marcus Morris, and it is time now for tonight's Who Delivered, brought to you by Telfora. And Marcus Morris, one of the Morris twins out of the Philadelphia area, with 16 points, 7 of 10 from the field, and 7 rebounds. Coming up to that free throw line. And remember earlier, if you weren't with us, he dislocated a finger and went back to the training room and back on the floor. And so for the Longhorns, their next game will be against Nebraska. And they've got 5 days to get ready for that. Big 12 game coming up right here.
I would think in Texas practices, getting ready for that Nebraska game, that a great emphasis is put on Brown and Bradley at those two guard spots and alternating your inside people however you want to. But I think that is what I would look forward to from a coaching standpoint, of getting those two guys as my guards, because they're quick, they're strong, they can play the defense, and they contribute on the offense.
Brown draws a foul on the three. Taylor fouling him on the three, and Brown will come to the free throw line with 46 seconds to go.
I'm sure that's a play that Bill Self says to himself, did I see what I think I saw? I can't believe that I've got a player that did that.
Well, you had a chance to look at the schedule. As I told you, the next game was against Nebraska for the Jayhawks. And they will move along. Taylor goes out. Damian James gets a nice ovation from the Texas crowd here. He was their warrior tonight. Brown was their discovery. But James gave it all in underneath. Balbay back on the floor. And Brown tonight with a career game. Puts 23 up. Here comes Henry. Fine-looking freshman player. Probably needs another year of college before he's ready for the NBA, as I've watched him over several games. Need to work on that perimeter shot. And Brown drains another three.
Wouldn't hurt Henry to have 3 more years of college.
You rascal, you.
Then he would come away with a degree. He would be a much better player. And I think as I look at him, that would be my advice.
So there you have it, X. I can't say I disagree with a coach, but if they're coming to throw a bushel of money at you at a couple of years young, and think about it. So here's
the thing about Henry is he's a little bit of an in-between player.
Absolutely.
Is he a guard or is he a forward? And that's going to be his biggest challenge in moving up to the NBA.
So, Bob, there we see that Iowa State will be next for the Jayhawks. And then next Monday, Big Monday, we will be in College Station. Looking forward to seeing the Aggies, who are playing very well. And they will host Kansas.
Well, the thing that has given Kansas the most trouble tonight has been Texas half-court defense, which I think particularly in the second half has been very good. And defense is going to have to be a key factor in anybody with a chance to beat Texas.
Oh, what a spin by Clown. So the positive that's going to come out of this loss, there are going to be the stories here about Brown and his emergence today. 26 of his 28 points here in the second half, and he's got that quickness that you like to see with lead guards.
Well, not just that, but he's taken the ball into the lane a lot, and he has not really turned the ball over. In fact, as much as Brown has handled the ball, he's just had two turnovers. Now, he hasn't given it up for baskets very often, but I think that he has done such a good job in getting to the bucket. You know, 26 points and a half is an awful lot. And he's been able to score when he's made his move. But we saw that one great left-handed pass he made, so he is definitely capable of setting up other people to score.
And meanwhile, the Jayhawks just continue to march along, the number one team in the country. And they certainly are going to be a force to be reckoned with. And Hamilton from the corner.
Hamilton has a very, very poor body language right now. When he was taken out of the ball game, and that shot was just a part of his body language that I just didn't like.
Kansas 80, the Longhorns 68.